Are you gonna want me to move it over a little bit? Just turn it.
That's the one 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 that's Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Matt Anderson. For those who don't know me, my wife Liz is Stan's oldest daughter. And on behalf of Stan's family, thank you for coming, sharing your sympathies, prayers, and memories. Your presence is greatly appreciated. It is our desire today to remember Stan and to remember him well, to celebrate his life, to say our goodbyes, and to grieve with one another and proclaim the hope that Stan found in his Savior. The Bible says that God is the Father of all compassion and the God of all comfort. And we look to him today for strength. We look to him today for comfort and hope. Death reminds us that our lives are finite, that tomorrow is not promised to any of us. But God, however, has promised life in his Son. In death, we do not look to religion or ritual for help, but we look to a person, Jesus Christ. For to whom shall we go? Peter asked Jesus. You have the words of eternal life. In Matthew's gospel, Jesus calls out, "Come, come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest." May we come to Jesus for comfort and rest as we commit our loved one, Stan Galstad, into his arms. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we've gathered to remember Stan, the one you love, and to say our goodbyes. Grant us mercy and give us hope. We look now to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him, endured the cross, despising the shame, and is now seated at the right hand of the throne of God. He is able to sympathize with us and help us in our time of weakness and need. Amen. Our first reading is from the book of Psalms, chapter 139. You know that I, Lord, you know you have searched me and you know me. You know when I sit down and when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from afar. You search out my path and my lying down and are acquainted with all my ways. Even before a word is on my tongue, behold, O Lord, you know it altogether. You hem me in behind and before, and you lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is high. I cannot attain it. Where shall I go from your spirit? Where shall I flee from your presence? If I ascend to the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in Sheol, you are there. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there, your hand shall lead me, and your right hand shall hold me. If I say, surely darkness shall cover me, and the light above about me be night, even the darkness is not dark to you. The night is bright as day, for darkness is as light with you. For you formed me. You formed my inward parts. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works. My soul knows them very well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was being made in secret, intricately woven in the depths of the earth. Your eyes saw my unformed substance. In your book were written, every one of them, the days that were formed for me, when as yet there was none of them. How precious to me are your thoughts, O God. How vast is the sum of them. If I would count them, they would be more than the sand. I wake and you are still with me. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts, and see if there be any grievous way in me, and lead me in the way of everlasting. Next, we're going to listen to a hymn that was meaningful to Stan. It's titled, I Am But a Stranger Here, Heaven is My Home. The recording includes Stan's family members who sang and played the hymn, Marilyn, Liz, Greg, Kristin, Talitha, Josiah, and me. This is in honor of Stan. You may have picked up a lyric sheet when you came in. Feel free to reflect on the words as you listen, and we will be singing verses 1, 3, and 4. We asked for folks to send us their memories of Stan, and I'd like to read a few of those that we've received. This is from Andrew Enestvedt, who Stan was his father-in-law. And he said this, it seems that almost universally everyone remembers how great of a music teacher Stan was. Andrew says, I'll always remember how we connected through our shared youthful sense of humor. He continues and said, Stan was an amazing teacher who changed lives through the shared language of music, helping to raise three wonderful children into the adults that they've become is another testament to who he was and what he stood for. What Andrew will miss most is his easy laughter and sense of humor will be greatly missed. And his favorite memory of Stan was on Andrew's wedding day, he shared a humorous moment with Stan that he'll never forget. You might need to ask Andy afterwards what that's all about. But we'll just leave it at that. Next memory is from Shannon Selner Watron, who was a band student of Stan. She says, what would you say about Stan? She says, his passion for teaching students the joy of music and learning and achieving something difficult and challenging. When you think of Stan, she says, I think of inspirational mentor, advisor, and fun. And her favorite memory of Stan was when Mr. Galstad would give us a fun piece of music to play in band or pep band. He showed his fun side by dancing and singing along. He truly enjoyed the music and the students he was working with. I loved his spirit and passion. He helped me in band and pushed me to work hard on new music. The next memory is from John and Anit Amato. Stan was a piano teacher for our sons, Tim and Todd. He was kind enough to include me as a pianist for the choir at Good Shepherd and a good friend in the Lord. He taught me how to make great coffee in the coffee maker using instant coffee. I vowed to keep it a secret. He was a gentle, kind man who loved Jesus and wasn't afraid to share him with others. We have been gone from Minnesota for many years, but we'll always have fond memories of Stan, Sandy, and his children. What they'd say about Stan is his gift of music and his love of Jesus. Another memory is from Penny Johnson. She is one of Stan's daughter, Liz. She's Stan's daughter, Liz's roommate from college. What would you say about Stan, his music and humor and his faith? Your favorite memory of Stan was, I stayed with Stan, Sandy, and Kristin for a weekend when they lived in Sleepy Eye and I was in college and researching Laura Ingalls Wilder for a journalism paper. It was not the best time of year to visit Walnut Grove as the museum wasn't open. Stan pointed that out to me, but it was worth the trip to stay with them. I remember laughing probably at Liz's expense and feeling welcome. I am blessed to know the family as family through many years of friendship. May you recall all the sweet times together. And then the final memory shared was from Gary Anderson. Gary says that what Stan did while teaching his students, he gave them the willpower to accomplish the best outcomes many times. They often receive superior ratings at their contests. They accomplished something great because of his encouragement, and I'm sure that they carried this will to succeed in their private lives. Stan accomplished what many of us never will. He had a purpose-driven life. Thanks, Stan, old, loyal, and faithful servant. Until we meet again, rest in peace. Thank you so much for those who shared memories, and thank you for all the memories you're sharing today with one another. My message for Stan is a friend in Jesus. A friend in Jesus. In the Gospel of John, chapter 15, Jesus said to his disciples, "This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, that someone lay down his life for his friends. You are my friends, if you do what I command you. No longer do I call you servants, for a servant doesn't know what his master is doing, but I have called you friends. For all that I have heard from my Father, I have made it known to you." Stan grew up in Neillsville, Wisconsin. His dad owned a photography studio where Stan would work after school. He would run the front of the studio while his dad took wedding photos. Stan remembered this as being a non-paid contribution to the family. In school, he felt like he was one of the outcasts. A learning disability kept him from excelling at reading and other subjects. But music was a different story. Stan excelled at music. Band class proved to be the place where Stan felt he truly belonged. It was there that he felt for the first time that he could succeed at something. And succeed he did. Stan had a gift. He was able to take a group of musicians and work with them in such a way that they would produce the most glorious music. Stan's first memories of church was the music. He loved it. He loved the interplay between all the parts. He was fascinated by it. At the age of 16, he was conducting his church's children's choir. His sister Marilyn was one of those young singers in Stan's choir. And from there, Stan would grow as a musician. His band teacher had a positive effect. Stan felt comfortable with him, and Stan knew that he wanted to teach band. And so he did. But it was a long road from his initial desire to fulfillment. Stan's first teaching position came at the age of 44 in Sleepy Eye, Minnesota. It was there that Stan would begin a successful career as a band teacher, taking his kids to new heights and spreading his love for music. Stan taught in Sleepy Eye for 13 years and Jordan for 8 years before retiring. His bands were recognized multiple times with superior ratings at contests, and he was Teacher of the Year in both Sleepy Eye and Jordan with many other accolades. Stan was close to his older sister, Kathleen. He adored her. They had a special connection and friendship. Kathleen would write letters to Stan while she was in school, letting him know that she was praying for him. Kathleen's sudden death at an early age had a traumatic effect on Stan. He had lost a family member, a confidant, and a close friend. Stan's younger sister, Marilyn, looked up to him and looked to him for help. He was her hero. She considered him the good one. He was full of love and ever so talented with music and working with musical groups. Stan married Sandy before finishing college, and they lived in Taylor, Wisconsin. In his words, they were like a team and made for each other. Their fledgling attempt at running a business, a local grocery store, did not pan out as they had planned, and they had to sell at a loss. This was a great discouragement for Stan. It was during this time that their first daughter was born, Elizabeth Kathleen, or Bitsy, as she was known then. They later moved to Cokato, where Stan worked a plethora of jobs, from factory work to a paper route to working with individuals with intellectual disabilities at a summer camp. At this time, Greg and Kristin were born. Stan was a man of faith. Prayer was a daily part of his life. Stan would often wake up early in the morning and pray. I have a vivid memory of staying at Stan and Sandy's house one night, and when I came downstairs for something, I found Stan praying on his knees in front of his lazy boy chair. I always knew that Stan was praying for my ministry, my family, and for me personally. God hears prayer, and Stan firmly believed in that, and he lived it. Family was important to Stan. He committed his children to God along with his grandchildren, and he prayed for his kids' spouses. Seeing God work through their lives, the lives of his kids and his grandkids, was a joy and wonder for Stan. Stan read the Bible daily. I have fond memories of Stan reading the Bible in his chair. In fact, we had to routinely buy him new Bibles for Christmas because he would read through them. His fingers would smear the print away from the pages. Stan said he had a hunger for God's word. He was hungry for it. Although most people knew Stan as a successful band teacher, he struggled with anxiety and depression all of his life. He often felt like a failure. It wasn't until Stan's later years that he began to fully understand God's grace and forgiveness in Jesus Christ. He grew up with the belief that three strikes and you're out. But Stan wasn't out. Jesus was his Savior. Scripture was a key ally in his battle against depression. He would daily go over passages of Scripture and write them out on a yellow notepad. We know he did this often because each page's written scripture passages were traced over and over again. Stan knew that Jesus loved him and that Jesus was a Savior and friend. Many of you know the hymn "In the Garden," and in the chorus of the song, it sings, "He walks with me, he talks with me, he tells me I'm his own, and the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known." Now, I can't recall Stan as being an outdoors nature guy, but he certainly enjoyed talking with Jesus in prayer, and most specifically, being reminded that Jesus called Stan his own. With Jesus, Stan felt truly listened to, no matter what he was going through. He could talk to Jesus in prayer. Whereas he had trouble expressing himself with others, he could pour his heart out to Jesus. I titled this message, "A Friend in Jesus," because Stan saw Jesus as his true friend. He had trouble connecting with others and never really felt like he had close friends, but he connected with Jesus. At his baptism in 2015, Stan said, "Jesus has come to me as a friend. He has helped me, who never felt loved, to feel loved and begin to want to give it to everybody else. For the first time in my life, I feel connected to someone. I've been overwhelmingly, mercifully, lovingly listened to unendingly by him. So I want to proclaim Jesus Christ as my Savior, my Lord, my King, and my God." Stan trusted Jesus. He trusted his family to Jesus. His faith wasn't perfect, but it was real. He didn't always express himself in the clearest way, but he loved God and he loved others. Sandy, he prayed for you. Liz, he prayed for you. Greg, he prayed for you. Kristin, he prayed for you. Stan knew he was a sinner, but more importantly, he knew that he belonged to Jesus. His prayer and last wish was that others would also trust Jesus. Liz, Stan's oldest daughter, said that her biggest hope for Dad, now that he is healed and whole in heaven, is that he fully understands the impact that he truly did make on others and how God used him and worked through him to bless those around him, whether they were his students, his friends, or his family. Because he didn't impact us, he wasn't perfect by any stretch of the imagination, and he would admit that. He will be greatly missed. Stan, we love you. Jesus said, I have called you friends. May we come to know Jesus as our Savior, Lord, and friend. Amen. At this point, in response to God's word, we will sing the hymn, Great is Thy Faithfulness. You're invited to sing along. As we say the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Please receive a benediction and blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen. You may be seated as we conclude our time together with a committal prayer. Dear family and friends, we lay to rest Stan's body. As a minister of the gospel, I declare the mystery of faith and the hope of eternal life. In 1 Corinthians 15, we read, I tell you this, brothers and sisters, flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall be changed in a moment, in a twinkling of the eye at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we shall be changed. For this perishable body must put on the imperishable, and this mortal body must put on immortality. When the perishable puts on the imperishable and the mortal puts on immortality, then shall come to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Let us pray. Lord, we commit Stan's body to you in this resting place, knowing that you have promised eternal life in your Son, Jesus Christ. Our mortal life will put on immortality, and we will be forever with you. Provide peace and comfort now, we ask, as we say our final goodbyes. Grant us faith and trust to trust your promises and power to love one another here on earth. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Well, thank you so much for coming today and sharing this day with Stan's family. Thank you, family and friends, for coming. At this point, our service is concluded. I'll have Sandy and her family and go out first, and then you're excused as we finish, as they enter into the foyer out there. Thank you again. Lord's blessings to you.
Yeah.